Good morning, I'm Nathan Sanderson. I'm the Public Information Officer for the Incident Management Team operating here in Southeast South Dakota. To lead off our comments this morning at this press conference, I'd like to call on Governor Dennis Dugard.
Circulation door motor that opens up. Open up the glove box, take the screws out of the...
Good morning, someone's on the line without being mute. They're working on their glove box, I understand. Good morning, and thank you all for being with us this morning to help cover the continuing flood fight in the southeast area of South Dakota on the Missouri River. The good news today is that yesterday we had no safety incidents, no injuries that I'm aware of, no fatalities, and that is something we continue to celebrate every day. And I ask all citizens who are working urgently to safeguard their property to continue to make safety their first concern, personal safety their first concern. When we first arrived in the southeast area more than a week ago, Lieutenant Governor Matt Michaels and I, there was no doubt that Dakota Dunes, Windstone, and other areas would be inundated by the Missouri River. But I want to say a special thank you today for the officials in Yankton, Clay, and Union counties who responded, who have stepped up and initiated a valiant effort to protect their communities and save as many homes as possible in the amount of time we've had. Folks like Dan Limoges, the Union County Sheriff, Paul Scherzlich, the Yankton County Emergency Manager, and Yankton Mayor Dave Quaff, Don Fuchsa, the mayor of North Sioux City, Ray Rogo, the emergency manager for Union County, and Doyle Carpin, the county commissioner, Al Lieber and Stacy Trobaugh here at Dakota Valley School District, Joshua Wendling at Windstone, head of the Homeowners Association there, and a generous philanthropist, Kevin Vaughn, there in Windstone, Paul Boyd, the hydrologist from the Army Corps of Engineers, Jay Woods, who's here with us today, Rick Wegger and Tim Brown, the lead contractors on the gargantuan task of erecting a sizable levee at Dakota Dunes, an effort that is largely completed. Colonel Webster and the South Dakota National Guard, I'm so proud of our National Guard soldiers who responded, dropped everything, left their jobs and homes, and came to the southeast area to help. The American Red Cross, the Salvation Army, and thousands of volunteers who have generously donated their time to help their communities, help their friends and their neighbors. Special thanks to Joe Lowe and his team, the incident management team, who came and have run this operation in the southeast area. We have had tremendous success. My heart goes out to those homes, those families whose homes have fallen victim to flood waters. I know the river will claim still more, but we've managed to protect hundreds of homes in the past week in places like Yankton, Windstone, McCook Lake, Deer Run, and Dakota Dunes. We should finish the Mud Lake levee today. We've been airlifting large sandbags to that area, which is too swampy for vehicle traffic. The state land adjacent to the Windstone area is finished sandbagging today. I was with the National Guard there yesterday, and I was so proud of our troops who stood in the water to sandbag the plastic face of a sand levee there. They were working hard and were glad to be helping. In Dakota Dunes, the levee is at 1100 in virtually all points except those that there's heavy traffic upon, and I expect that those points will be at 1100 by today. Riprap continues to be placed. All that being said, those levees that protect so many homes must continue to be monitored. We expect to see seepage behind the levees. We'll see boils behind the levees, and those incidents must be monitored and corrective action applied. We know Gavin's Point will go to 150 CFS release on Tuesday, and that will be the full test of all our defenses. But in the meantime, we want to celebrate our progress and continue that progress with persistence and determination, and I know we will.
Thank you, Governor. Next, we'll turn to Lee J. Templeton with the Army Corps of Engineers, who will be joining us on the phone. Lee J.
Good morning. My name is Lee J. Templeton, U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. First, I'll cover some information on the Owyhee project. The current elevation of the reservoir is at 1618.74 as of this morning. Our current releases are at 150,000 CFS, which will continue for the foreseeable future. Now I'll cover some information on the Gavin's Point project and specifically some areas around the Dakota Dunes. The current reservoir elevation there is holding steady. Current releases today are 145,000 CFS, and it will remain that way at that flow rate until the 14th of June, in which we will then increase to 150,000 CFS, which is the max, the currently scheduled max flow rate. That's all I have for my report. Thank you.
Thank you, Lee J. Also here at Dakota Valley High School, we have Jay Woods, the public affairs specialist for the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. He'll be available to answer questions regarding the Corps' support down here in the southeast area, particularly their work on the northern segment of the Dakota Dunes levee system. So he'll be available following general comments, available for questions. Next, we'd like to turn to a few of our community leaders. To start things off, I'd like to introduce Mayor Don Fuksa of North Sioux City.
Thank you, Nathan. As far as the North Sioux City McCook Lake area goes, our infrastructure is currently running as normal with no foreseeable problems right now. City staff is standing by as needed to take care of any of the situations as they may arise. As far as the levee the governor spoke about, that is on the south side of McCook Lake, by the end of this evening, the levee should be completed with the plastic and sandbagging efforts. That levee does continue through the Adams Nature Area where the helibags have been, hundreds of helibags have been put into place. The National Guard will continue their plastic and sandbagging efforts to tie into Windstone. That's all I have here, and we'll stand by for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Next, we'll hear from Josh Wendling, the president of the Homeowners Association at Windstone.
Yeah, as the governor stated earlier, our east levees on through Windstone into the Adams Nature area have been pretty much completed. They will be completed probably within the next hour or two, and we will be moving our residents and volunteers over to a west levee that will be completed by the end of the day. That west levee will run from the west side of Brookside all the way down a piece of farm ground and Windstone property. It's about a mile long levee. That should be completed by the end of the day with sandbags. We also started doing a little dewatering on our end with our local canals. We are going to lower those water levels in those ponds to try and create some sort of ground seepage that will seep into our ponds, and then we will pump it out as needed. We will lower those waters there probably 2 to 3 feet. Currently those ponds are 8 feet deep. So if you do see some water levels dropping in those ponds, you know why that is happening, and we can answer any of those questions regarding those ponds down the road. Again, this undertaking out of Windstone really would not have been completed without the help of obviously our National Guard folk that helped with the East Levee, our community levee there, our residents, volunteers, and local businesses that have shut down some of their plants for days and had their employees come out and actually help sandbag and complete the operation out there. So a big thanks go out to our residents, our volunteers, and our businesses that have helped in this process. So I'll be available for questioning afterwards as well. Thank you.
With an update on Dakota Dunes, we'll hear from Jeff Dooley of the Community Improvement District.
Good morning. Before I get started, I want to pass along a thanks on behalf of our residents to the National Guard, to Governor Dugard and Lieutenant Governor Michaels, the incident command team, and the, all the volunteers that have helped in this process. It has been a good experience in seeing everybody come together for one objective, to build levees and protect infrastructure and property. So, again, on behalf of Dakota Dunes residents, I really want to thank everybody involved. I wanted to just talk a little bit about to those folks that have homes in the evacuated zone. We've been getting a lot of questions about when they will be able to re-enter that area to check on their homes. The incident command team is in the process of developing a credentialing system and a plan that will allow Dakota Dunes residents that live in that evacuation zone to get back at, into their homes at some point to check on it and to do some maintenance work. When that plan is implemented is really dependent on a couple of things. One is the levee system needs to be tested against the 150,000 release from Gavin's Point. That'll be done next week. Once that water's there, we can see how the levee is reacting to that water. The second part of that equation is we need to get our dewatering system up and running to see what elevation is realistic and achievable. And then also we have to evaluate access roads within the evacuated zone so that residents that want to get in can get in. Once we understand what those conditions are within the evacuation zone, we can look at trying to implement a plan. And we're working at that, and I want to emphasize we all understand the sense of urgency that some of the residents have in that area that want to get back in there. We want to get them back in there, but we need to make sure the conditions are suitable to allow that to happen. So we are working on that, and we'll be talking about it in the future. I also wanted to talk a little bit to the residents that are not in the evacuation zone, namely in the Meadows and the Prairie. Please don't think that just because you're outside the evacuated zone, everything is okay. We will have groundwater fights in those areas as well. We're able to do that on an individual home basis there because people are still in those homes and there's electricity there. But for those folks that are living in the Meadows and the Prairie, you need to be prepared to for the eventuality that groundwater will become an issue. And you need to be ready for it. And I think a lot of people have taken steps to do that. But we need to continue to prepare in those areas and don't get complacent thinking that the fight is over just because we've got levees in place and a dewatering system in the evacuation area. So with that, I will stand down and stay tuned for questions. Thanks.
Thanks, Jeff. Down here in the southeast area, the Rocky Mountain Incident Management Team C has been in charge of operations. And the incident commander for that management team is Joe Lowe. So right now I'd like to have Joe come up and make a few comments about the operations happening here in the southeast area.
Thank you, Nathan. Again, Joe Lowe, Incident Commander, Rocky Mountain Team C. I want to say a couple things. When we came here a short time ago, we came with an unbending will. We weren't going to stand down. We were going to fight the good fight with you. Understand that once we embed ourselves with you in the community, we feel your pain, we feel your successes, we feel basically the pulse of that community. So you're not forgotten ever by us. A couple of things that we need to talk about too is the levee systems. Most of the levee systems throughout the southwest area are nearing completion. One thing, word of caution, when we met with the Corps this morning, I guess the soundbite and takeaway that I want to give you is that this levy is starting to feel the full effects of 150,000 cubic feet per second. It's going to take about 2 weeks to see how this is going to affect that levy and how stable it is. That's the earliest. We're starting to see and evaluate the effects of this levee system right now. You know, this has been a ground and air assault. Yesterday, Black Hawk and Chinook helicopters transported over 800,000 pounds of sand and for levee construction operations. That's quite an airlift. We get down starting at you know, the southern area. I want to elaborate a little bit on that and hit some high points. There's about 50 homes still in the Miners Bend area, and 19 in the Cottonwood Lakota Landing area. Again, the water's rising very quickly, and we're at 145,000 cubic feet per second today, tomorrow, and then it starts ramp up to the final push. Right now, you're seeing eroding of the ground that you're holding, and so my best advice to you is, you know, it's your family, it's you, and I'd start to be moving out of that area because in the Lakota Landing Cottonwood area, that old riverbed has started to reclaim itself, and what it's done is it's really kind of isolating you out on that that point. McCook Lake, the levee southwest of McCook Lake near the Adams Homestead and Nature Preserve is largely completed with hundreds of one-ton bags in place. More than 400,000 pounds of sand was used in that operation. Windstone, that's another success. And again, that is a success. Much of that was community effort. I was over there. I saw you folks. I saw you, that community pull together. I saw the resolve that you all had over there to make that happen. And with some help from the National Guard troops on the state lands there, and some of our hand crews and division folks and management people that we have working over there, I'm quite confident that you're looking real good right now. You're going to have some dewatering issues to take care of. It's starting to stabilize over there. We're starting to move to a point where I'm feeling comfortable now over there. We get down to Dakota Dunes. We talk about that. That levee, the magnitude of that levee, that's about 6 miles of levee, and it was completed in this short time frame. And it's the average heights on there. When you're looking at it from the backside of the levee, you're looking at 10 to 11 foot of levee in places. So that was quite an effort with everybody involved there. I do have to say some things about Dakota Dunes. There was a plan in place when we got there. It was acted upon. When a national team comes in and you look at it, sometimes you have to scrap what was being done and you can't add on to it. In this place, in this case, there was good things in place. And we were able to be much further ahead on where we are now and obtain and reaching our tactical objectives because of the good work that was done by the district itself and also the contractors. Mainly that levee will be completed as of today and starting to do some capping operations on it. Dewatering is still ongoing, and we're looking optimistically that we have a success in that area. So I'll stand by for questions afterward. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. With a few wrap-up comments, I'll turn it back over to Governor Dennis Dugard.
I just want to reiterate some things that Jeff Dooley stated during his comments about the Dakota Dunes evacuation area. As he stated, this is a very large levee, and Joe and I both celebrated the rapid work of both the improvement district and the contractors to get this work done. But even as it's being finished in the next couple of days, it'll feel the full force of the 150 CFS flow Tuesday and Wednesday of this week. And the contractors continue to have trucks on the levee, placing riprap, raising those last stretches to 1100 and getting the work done. When that is done, then as Jeff mentioned, there will be a credentialing system in place to allow residents to get back in, and more importantly, to exclude people who have no business there and who have the wrong intentions when they go in there. So I encourage the residents to understand and applaud Jeff and his team for arranging this, because it is designed to protect especially those residents when they are not within the exclusion zone or within the evacuated zone. Even though these levees seem very formidable and strong at this stage, we are going to see continued seepage from below on the inside of the levee. We're going to see boils from time to time. All these things must be managed, and we're hopeful that we can manage them. But for a period of time here, it's still going to be very uncertain. The levee looks strong, but there's other means for the water to find its way in, and we're going to work against it with lots of dewatering. And I know Jeff and Dennis have put together a contract with Northern Dewatering. They've got 15 very large pumps, five pumps to move water from within the evacuated area to another area within the evacuated area, and 10 pumps to take it out over the top of the levee and get it out. Even though we want to dewater the interior area, there are some areas where we may not dewater against the possibility that too much dewatering weakens the ability of the levee to hold. So we're told by the hydrologists that the difference between the exterior river height and the interior water elevation, groundwater elevation, should not go to a difference of greater than 6 feet. So to put it more succinctly, there will be some points on the outside of the levee, on the upstream side, where the river will reach 1096, we believe, at 150 CFS, and we cannot take the groundwater below 1090. What that means is some basements will flood. But there will be other basements within the area that we're hoping residents can take steps to dewater or maintain a dry state. That situation is evolving, and I ask the residents to remember that even as we want to help them protect their property, we also want them to be keenly aware of the risk of entering the evacuation zone. And so as we have information, we'll continue to make it available to you so that you can make a judgment about the risk you want to take when access is available to credentialed residents and their contractors. Thank you.
Thank you, Governor. We'll take a few questions here at Dakota Valley High School, and then I'll open it up for questions on the phone. So to begin, are there any questions from the audience members here?
Yes, I'm just curious. The contractors that are working on this construction project, is this considered a federally funded project like what falls under the Davis-Bacon Act?
The question is, for the contractors working on the projects, is this considered a federally funded project?
There is one levee that was constructed by the Corps of Engineers. That's the northern segment of the Dakota Dunes system. The Corps came in and had the time and willingness to implement that solution. And so that work was undertaken at Corps expense, and the Corps is paying for it. Every other aspect of protection that is being installed, whether by a county organization or by a city, may be eligible for a partial reimbursement by FEMA. That decision as to whether FEMA will reimburse a government organization for implementing protective measures is a case-by-case determination. If the protective measures very clearly protect primarily public infrastructure, protect a road, protect the water system, protect the sewer lift station. If those protective measures very clearly protect primarily public infrastructure, the likelihood of reimbursement, and I'm talking about 75% reimbursement by FEMA, is higher. In those areas where protective measures were implemented that primarily protect private property and only a small amount of public infrastructure is also protected, the likelihood of reimbursement by FEMA is lower. But each case is a determination by FEMA on a case-by-case basis. A qualified applicant must be an organized unit of government or a 501 organization. So an individual citizen or a private group of for-profit homeowners typically will not qualify as an applicant to FEMA. So it really depends in each case. But that was a very good question. Thank you.
I was wondering what the status of the business community at Exit 1 is, and if there's any plans to reopen that exit safely anytime in the near future.
Take that, Jeff. The question was, what is the status of the business community at Exit 1 in Dakota Dunes, and is there any, or are there any plans to open that exit?
Jeff Dooley with Dakota Dunes. We fully expect the business community in Dakota Dunes to continue operations. The availability of Exit 1 for those people becomes more and more a reality as we finish up the levee work and there's less trucks going in. So I would anticipate working with South Dakota DOT to probably get that opened up here in the very, very near future so that the business community and its clients and customers can use Exit 1 to access Dakota Dunes as they have in the past.
Additional questions from the audience here at Dakota Valley? Seeing none, we'll open it up to any questions on the phone. Are there questions from media members on the phone?
Tony Mangan at KCCR Radio. Governor Dugard, if I could ask you, please, about the Pier 4 Pier situation. 5 days into it, with 150,000 CFS, are you feeling good about the way things are going? I mean, are they going better than you thought they would be going at this time?
I think they're going very well. I'm very pleased with the speed at which the levees were constructed and the quality of the levees. There are some levees in the north part of Fort Pier that the last I saw did not have plastic on the riverside face, and I don't know if it's safe to place that plastic. Those are going to be more erodible by the water action, and so those are certainly more vulnerable. I also think that the channel entry into Marion's Garden represents a vulnerability point, and I know that people are carefully monitoring that point. All that being said, I think the strength of the levees looks very good. I've seen few boils or seepage issues. It's difficult on the Fort Pier side to judge that because they've had some problems with the Fifth Street storm sewer. And again, when I came down to Dakota Dunes yesterday morning, to my knowledge, that was still problematic. I know on the Pier side, they've also had trouble with one of their very large sewer lines, and so seepage in those areas is difficult to judge whether it's seepage or whether it's storm water finding its way through the outlets, which have now become inlets back into the area behind the dikes. But I think most people are protected. Again, my heart goes out to those people along the golf course in Lower Pier, downstream pier, and also to those people on the upstream side of Fort Pier where levees could not be constructed in time and where their personal levees around their homes have been inundated. I know there are still some fighting the good fight, and I sure hope they're successful. But otherwise, Tony, I'd say overall the levees are doing their job, and I'm very pleased and hopeful.
Thank you.
Other questions from the phone?
This is Holly Monte from the Sioux City Journal.
Go ahead with the Sioux City Journal.
Okay, thank you. We've been hearing that officials may have entered some homes in Dakota Dunes because of fears of sewer backups. I wondered if there was anyone that can answer if this is true, and if it is, what was the extent of the situation, and if it's not, is it a possibility in the future?
This is Jeff Dooley with Dakota Dunes. While we were preparing to work with the Corps was preparing to build the northern segment of the Dakota Dunes levee system. We identified a potential problem along that corridor that if residents along that corridor hadn't plugged their storms or their sewer drains in their floors and their toilets properly, that, you know, in the event that that northern levee would be utilized, the water would just run into the houses on the south side, run through the drains, and then up through the north side. So we did take some steps to enter those homes with the help of the sheriff to make sure that those homes were properly plugged all along Pinehurst. And we did that to make sure that the integrity of the northern segment of the levee was good. And that's as far as we went, as far as plugging private homes. But we did go into some homes to plug those floor drains, but it was in the interest of the integrity of the north levee. Thanks.
And as a follow-up, how many homes do you think you went in, and did you find any problems at this point?
Well, I don't know the exact number of homes. It was probably, I'll say, 30 or 40 or so, but along that corridor. And, you know, there were some of those that hadn't plugged their floor drains. We plugged it for them. Some of them did plug some of their floor drains, but they missed some. So it was kind of a variety. Some had them all plugged, some didn't. So it was a variety of situations. But at the end of the day, most of them, if not all of them, got plugged.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Mr. Clymer, AP in Sioux Falls. I'm wondering, you had mentioned some water still approaching some of the homes in Dakota Dunes. Is there any estimate on how many homes in the Dakota Dunes or greater Dakota Dunes area are dealing with water right up to the house at this point?
This is Jeff Dooley again. To give you a perspective of the size of the evacuated area, there's about 480 homes in that area, you know, and some of them on the lower end, that were on the lower, on the southern portion of the development, there are groundwater issues in that area, like as the governor had mentioned earlier. We expect that there are going to be some basements that have water in them until we can get down in there and review that stuff and allow residents to get in to go into their homes. We don't have an exact number, but we do know that there will be some in areas that were subject to flooding in earlier times. Some of the newer developments on the southern end were built up a little higher, so, you know, they won't have as much problem, but I guess as a general rule, we know there is water in some basements, but we just do not at this time know the extent of it.
Any additional questions?
Yeah, this is Randy Doctor for the President of Conan Yankton. I wondered if the governor or somebody else could follow up on, we're getting reports of problems with the, a couple things. The sediment is creating more problems, flooding down in the Springfield area, and also the new warnings that are coming out about the debris and currents at Lewis and Clark Lake, advisements for boaters and anybody else along those areas. I wonder if you could address those areas.
This is the governor. I'm unaware of the problems in Springfield right now, and if you could clarify that.
There's concerns. It's worsening, and in some areas the floodwaters is pushing debris and the sediment not only downstream but out of the banks. Especially to the south, there was a highway in Nebraska that was covered by a lot of the debris and the sediment, and I wondered if you foresee the sediment to be pushed downstream or more out of its banks, that kind of thing.
Yes, well, I've canoed that stretch around Springfield and running water immediately above Springfield on the river, and there is a tremendous amount of sedimentation that has deposited itself, I would say, from upstream of running water all the way down downstream of Springfield. And there's no question that this higher flow will bring and carry sediment downstream. Whether it will remain suspended and work its way through the Gavin's Point release, I can't say. Whether it will settle in the Lewis and Clark Lake, I guess time will tell. I would think that the significant flow that's occurring in Lewis and Clark Lake will carry much of that sediment still suspended downstream of Gavin's Point Dam. That's just an uneducated governor's, a non-hydrologist evaluation. So take it for what it's worth.
No, I appreciate that, Governor. Just to follow up then also, I believe a warning's gone out for boaters on Lewis and Clark with all the debris in that. Is that bringing some additional concerns as well?
Yes, there is. As the water has come up into areas that typically does not see overland flow, there's things that are found on the land that are now being picked up by the water. We have tried to identify hazardous objects. Even yesterday, I know the Black Hawk helicopter crews were identifying, for example, gas tanks that are adjacent to irrigation pumps that are generator driven, trying to get those gas tanks. I know we saw one from the air. I saw one myself and helped them mark it, its GPS location, so it could be secured and not become a floating object. But there's plenty of things floating in the water. And as those things make their way downstream, they do become hazards.
Thank you.
Any other calls from media members on the phone? Any other calls here at the Dakota Valley High School? With no further questions, thank you for your time and attention. Have a good day.